Let me begin by thanking Governor Yuzaki and the people of Hiroshima for hosting us here at this meeting. And I am especially honored to be a member of the formulation committee for the Hiroshima for Global Peace Plan. I'm looking forward to coming back to your city later in July when there'll be a series of activities around the Hiroshima for Global Peace Plan. Today, I would like to talk to you about nuclear security and lessons learned from Fukushima, because I believe, based on both research and this week here in Japan, that the government of Japan and the people of Japan have done a very admirable job of dealing with the safety lessons to improve the safety to prevent accidents caused by natural disasters at nuclear power plants in Japan. I also believe, however, that the efforts to improve the security of nuclear power plants, that is, the prevention of insider threats, terrorist threats, or sabotage, have not been as well adjusted inside Japan. And as has been noted, the basic cause of the Fukushima accident, the loss of a backdrop of emergency power supplies for the coolant for the spent fuel ponds, could have been caused by a natural disaster as it was, or could have been caused by a terrorist or sabotage. You've come a long way to prevent the accident and have come less far to prevent future sabotage incidents. And this is especially tragic to note in that the United States, after the September 11th terrorist attacks, changed our backup requirements for emergency supply to spent fuel ponds to prevent a failure, fearing that a terrorist attack could come against a nuclear reactor facility. The information that we had adopted new rules to stop such incidents, what were called the B5B security orders, were passed on prior to the Fukushima accident to the Nuclear Industry Security Agency, but were not recognized as being important and were not passed on to TEPCO. And as the National Diet report noted, had those recommendations from the United States been passed on to TEPCO and had TEPCO fully implemented those changes, the backup systems would have been better and the accident of 311 might have been prevented. Now, I believe that serious sabotage or terrorist attacks against nuclear reactors are rare. But rare events happen. Indeed, by my own count, and that of the Austrian scholar Fritz Steinhauser, there have been at least 18 known incidents in 10 different countries on 6 different continents. Rare events across the globe happen rarely, but happen. These have ranged from serious incidents, such as 1972, in which hijackers successively seized an American jet, commercial jet, flew it over the Oak Ridge nuclear facility in Tennessee and threatened to crash into it unless they received a handsome payment to land the plane. These have included attacks against nuclear power plants under construction or built. They have included efforts to steal materials from institutes, and most recently have included at least a double penetration by 2 different gangs into the Pelindaba facility in South Africa, with the individuals reaching all the way up to the control room of the central facility. There have been, as far as I know, no terrorist attacks or sabotage attacks since the 3/11 accident here, although I fear that terrorists could look at what had happened and see the grave, tragic cost that occurred and would want, perhaps, to increase or to repeat such costs elsewhere. We do know of at least three different anti-nuclear protesters since 3/11 who in France, Sweden, and most recently last summer, again at Oak Ridge in Tennessee, three individuals, including an 82-year-old nun, successfully got through the security fences of the facility and made it all the way up to the nuclear facility itself to protest what they said was inadequate security, and turned out to be accurate in terms of the inadequate security. Moreover, we should not assume that the death of Osama bin Laden and the subsequent weakening of the al-Qaeda organization has meant that terrorists no longer pose a serious threat, because the danger of nuclear terrorism is not confined to the al-Qaeda organization. Here I show pictures of the revolutionary cell leaders in West Germany who tried unsuccessfully to acquire a nuclear weapon from U.S. bases, the Red Brigades in Italy that also tried to seize materials and a weapon, Chechen rebels which have threatened nuclear materials theft and use in radiological bombs, and even the Aum Shinrikyo, we should recall, was interested in acquiring a nuclear weapon for their apocalyptic vision of how the world should end and they would survive. So let me conclude by noting that while you have done a great deal to improve the safety of plants by adding many backup plans, new regulatory agencies that we'll hear about later, I believe that not enough has been done to improve nuclear power plant security. In particular, there are no background checks required by law for individuals involved in critical, often sometimes very important, roles inside nuclear power plants. The kinds of background checks that are routine in most countries that have serious nuclear power capabilities. The Advisory Committee on Nuclear Security report calls for new trustworthiness tests to be implemented at all Japanese nuclear power plants, but thus far there has been no progress in that regard in the Diet in Tokyo. Some have argued that that's not necessary because you can have a two-man rule to have two individuals rather than one person in critical activities, and yet I would argue that if you take two individuals, neither of whom have background checks, it could actually backfire by having two unreliable people or two people with terrorist sympathies actually actively colluding. Some people have argued that you can have a collegial reporting system whereby you report on particular problems if you fear that someone is disloyal or has been corrupted. And yet, while that is helpful, such systems have proven in the past not to be perfect. And I'll conclude with two examples. An example of the two-man rule proving problematic and insufficient is the Indira Gandhi assassination of 1984, in which additional bodyguards were added to her personal security detail after she cracked down on the Sikh uprising in the Punjab. And Sikh separatists threatened to kill the prime minister. Additional bodyguards were put on, some of whom were Sikh, and Mrs. Gandhi argued that in a democracy, in a secular democracy, we should not have a way of restricting who is in the bodyguard as long as they have personal loyalty, and she trusted them. However, two Sikh guards together arranged to be there and pulled out their guns and assassinated Mrs. Gandhi in 1984. Adding a two-man rule can be helpful, but is not sufficient. Having reporting on colleagues can be helpful, but is also not sufficient. A recent example of this is the case of Sharif Mobley, who was arrested in Yemen in March 2010, was discovered to have joined al-Qaeda on the Arabian Peninsula, and have been in contact with the radical cleric Anwar al-Awlaki. And after he was arrested, it was discovered that he had been employed at five U.S. nuclear power facilities between 2002 and 2008. It became known that it is possible at the time to have a facility waive some of the background checks to permit temporary access if something is critical. And that in the case of Sharif Mobley, even though he had shown his radicalization to other members, other workers at the facility, telling one that non-Muslims are infidels and telling another that we are brothers in the Union, but if holy war comes, watch out. Neither of those statements were reported at the time, even though rules told people that they should do so. Having collegial reporting is a useful thing to do, but is not foolproof. And so I will just conclude by noting that the Funabashi report, which I strongly recommend to you as an explanation for why the tragedy of 3/11 occurred, talked about a widespread belief in the myth of absolute safety, that accidents can't occur, when we now know that they can. I would like to also urge the people and the government of Japan to avoid the myth of absolute security, thinking that terrorist incidents or sabotage can occur. It can, and you should do what's necessary, including having background checks, to try to prevent sabotage, insider threats, and terrorism, and spend an equal attention on mitigation in case the unthinkable occurs despite all of our efforts to prevent it. Thank you very much.